Well, it's a little show for me. It's the last 10 years of 6 years' work is there, most of the last 5 years. And it's a little bit, it's maybe 1/10 of my work from the last 5 years. I make much more. Because you cannot hang everything. But yeah, I painted like, not today, but I work all the time. I work, that's my life. So that is why we let's see the show, how I work. But you cannot show everything, it's too much. You cannot show 10,000 paintings, huh?
No. You made 10,000 so far?
I don't know exactly.
I know another Dutch painter, Jan Slaughters, was a big worker too, and he made, they say now, 4,000 or 5,000 paintings.
Oh, Jan Slaughters. I've known.
Great stuff.
Yeah, he made very good artists, wasn't it, Jan?
Yeah,
Jan Slaughters is great. And beautiful nudes he paints. Fantastic.
The best, I think.
Yeah, the Some best, yes.
Yeah. When we're now in the 21st century, what do you see the role of the artist? We talked about the computer now. How do you see the artist? I mean, the art scene seems to be sort of floundering at this moment, but you've been pushing for more than 50 years in the art world. How do you see art now in the 21st century?
Well, and it's same as always. We live in the last 100 years, we live in a situation that there is an explosion of creativity in the last 100 years. It starts around Dada, Kurtzwieters, and later with Duchamp had a lot of influences in America. Kurtzwieters less, but I like Kurtzwieters as an artist very much, and very important. That's for me very important, I have to say. But after that we have an explosion from creativity all over the world, not only in Western Europe anymore, but also in America, later on now in America. So the Western world is bigger in creativity, in the artist world, you know. So I can only say that it's fantastic. Even if you like it or don't like it, it has nothing to do with it. The explosion of creativity is there, more than before, more than ever. In the time of the Renaissance, was not more than 4 or 5 people we know who make the Renaissance artists. That was all, you see. Also with the Cubism, I know 4. I have to think 4 Cubist artists. There are more around, but not so good, but not many, you know, anyway. It's always like that. And it is now the same. You have this explosion from creativity, and there you have some artists who have the essence of the work in them, you know. And that you have to see. Most people don't see it anymore. It's confusion. There's so much. But if you have the knowledge, the feeling to see that is the man and not this, you know, that is very important.
I noticed when we were at the Cobra yesterday that there was a lot of ethnic influence on your sculpture. You saw things from India and Pakistan and...
Yeah, my sculpture is travel
what
around
is
the
this?
World. I buy it all over, yes. It's an idea for me that I bring... I call it hybrid art. I bring all different cultures together, from different civilizations together, from different countries, and make one art piece out of it. I cut it, I saw, I nail, I put everything on, and then I paint it. And with the color of the paint, I make one sculpture out of it. That's why I call it hybrid art, let's say. Maybe not a good word, but to make it understandable, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Franz, we're here at the Cobra Museum for a big sculpture show of Karel Appel on his 80th birthday. Could you tell us a little about the origin of his sculpture? Most people know him as a painter.
There are many painters who do three-dimensional work. Doing three-dimensional work is a way to appropriate in a more physical way reality. Picasso did that before Karel, and Karel does it also, whereas I would make a distinction in the relation to the sculpture. In Picasso's case, Picasso tried out things three-dimensionally, and then he tried to project it on the surface to get two-dimensional. Karel is something different. He experiments. He is actually looking for the same thing in sculpture as he does in painting, but the sculpture has a material presence and triggers in a different way than a blank canvas can do.
Well, you said he is looking for the same thing as he's looking for in painting. What exactly is that?
He is looking actually for something very deep in himself. He's trying to find to go through the layers of clichés that everyone has to deal with in daily life, and he tries to find something very profound in himself, primitive, if you want. These, I guess, are very close to what you call emotions, thrives, these things which are primary. You could even say the animal condition. He's looking for that very much in art from psychopathological patients. You can see that in The Hague in the exhibition of drawings. He made these drawings in the late 40s, inspired by drawings made by psychopathological patients in Paris. And he was also very much inspired by children. The questioning children is a famous example, an early example. You know the story with the former city hall in Amsterdam. There was a break between the Netherlands and Karel Appel when this wall painting was rejected. So he left Holland saying, "I hate the Dutch." Because he had so much invested his emotions in that. And you see in this exhibition, it's quite exceptional, two of the wood relief versions of this theme, questioning children. The one comes very exceptionally from the Centre Pompidou. They had never landed, and I learned that the director had a personal intervention. He had to struggle with the restorers who didn't want to let it out. We didn't get it 10 years ago for the big retrospection in The Hague. So it's here. I was amazed. Another one is in the Tate that you will never get. And there is one in the Stedelijk. And now the one from the Centre Pompidou and the Stedelijk hang next to each other, which is quite exceptional.
Now, Appel's painting has developed over the years from the early, as you say, the psychological, where he felt compelled to illustrate the book on the on the show, which had no illustrations in it. Yeah. A wonderful concept. Mm. I love that.
It's actually almost a manifesto, a manifesto for his art, a visual manifesto.
Now tell me, has his three-dimensional sculptures and reliefs, have they developed in a certain way, like the paintings have evolved?
I wouldn't see their continuity in the development. It's more clusters, and that's how I installed the exhibition. You have a cluster of cobra works, you have a cluster of these olive trunk sculptures, you have a cluster of the 90s assemblage, and there is a cluster of the very recent work, the 2000, a cluster of monuments. So it's always developing around a theme, which is very much reacting to something that he picks up in reality. Some haphazard encounter, something that he runs into, which triggers something like the questioning children. That was an experience that he had when he went through Germany just after the war, and he saw all these kids along the railway begging for some food. That was something that he really was moved by, and that triggered this work. And it's always like that with Karel. It's something material or emotional that he comes across, and that triggers a new direction or kind of work, and that takes him out of the danger of making routine work. He always is very cautious to not come into a routine habit. He always want to break through that.
Now, I noticed that a lot of the more contemporary ones seem to borrow from different cultures. Yeah, you see something from India, something from Pakistan, something from somewhere else, Africa, whatever. Is this a theme that runs in the current kind of sculpture, or where does this come from?
This entirely, if you ask me, it comes from downtown Manhattan. Huh? Is that he has found some stores there where he can find all this stuff, and this is for him a perfect symbol for a melting pot, a fusion of cultures. And it's also a statement that he once wrote to Donald Cuspid, the American critic, about these sculptures, saying that he is very much against the new violence in international and globalism, and he wants to sort of make a statement for a friendly fusion between cultures, and that's what these, in his mind, what these things are about. But he finds most of the stuff in New York, and New York is a melting pot city, so it's normal.
And you can find anything in New York.
Yeah.
Now I've been told that he was somehow influenced by Kurt Schwethers.
Yeah.
What is the connection? I mean, Kurt worked mostly with paper and, went through some collage.
It's actually what my text in this folder for this exhibition starts with is, he saw an exhibition of Kurt Schwethers at the Stedelijk Museum when he was very young, and just afterward he made this Questioning Children wood release. That's what actually he saw this working with the Objet Trouvé, but there's also a clear difference to what Schwethers. Schwethers tried to arrange them according to a formal principle, whereas Karel uses to trigger something emotional in himself, and he sort of brings it into a direction of his emotion after that. So he painted on these, if you imagine these wood reliefs, these Questioning Children, without the paint on it, it could be a Schwethers almost, but he paints Questioning Children on it. Now if you remember that children like to play with wood blocks, there is a double attachment to the seam. So you have Schwethers, you have children who like to play with wood blocks, and Karel Appel who tries to find the child in himself.
Now, is it unique in the sculpture world that he would bring paint to it in such a profound way? I mean, as you say, it's an integral part of his sculpture. He paints it oftentimes in pasta. Mm. It sharpens, it changes the way the sculpture itself looks. Is this a unique feature of Karel Appel?
No, there are a lot of sculptures by painters. It's always almost a classical item in art history. I wouldn't say that Karel Appel is a typical sculptor. He is a painter who also makes sculptures. Even if there, you said you prefer the sculptures. That's a question of taste. But they are painterly sculptures. Particularly these olive trunks. A sculptor couldn't imagine, I think, about this kind of sculpture. It's really painting in three dimensions.
Oftentimes, when you look around here, you see a real diversity of style. With Appel, you say he's searching for something. Is he at 80 still searching?
Yes, sure. That's why in his mind he's still a young man. Huh? That's quite amazing about him. Huh? He's very lively. And that's because he keeps on searching things. Huh? He tries to find reality.
Franz, thank you very much for being with us. It's a wonderful show. I'm sure you're going to attract a lot of people. They love Karel Appel here.
Okay, thank you.
Bye-bye.